Hello and welcome to Economic Divide with me, Kavit Ahwai. In this week's episode, we will look at the Syrian war, or the war on Syria, should I say, which turned 10, a milestone to be ashamed of. I mean, what can be said about the Syrian war that has not been said already? Well, that is exactly the point. It needs to remain in the headlines. Now, before the war on Syria broke out, Syria had two main products for revenues, namely agriculture and oil. Together, they accounted for about one half of the country's GDP. Agriculture, for instance, accounted for about 26% of the GDP and employed 25% of the total labor force. Well, the sanctions and destruction have devastated Syria's economy. For example, the total economic loss from the Syrian civil war for the year 2015 was $237 billion. Now, it could have reached $400 billion for the year 2020, as far as the records go. Well, the Syrian opposition's capture cost the government a further $507 million a year because of the revenue loss at the border crossing, Nasib being the biggest one. In this program, we will not only try to cover the economic consequences of this war, but we will also give a touch of the humanitarian aspect, which is truly heartbreaking, scenes that will surely move you. Well, the first report will take a look at the timeline of this war, which has just marked its 10-year anniversary.
The Syrian tragedy will go down as one of the darkest chapters in recent history. The Syrian people are among the greatest victims of this century.
It started out with small protests. The Syrian government moved in to quell them. President Assad still held massive popularity. Protests got out of hand and soon swept the nation, like here in Homs. Terrorists filled the vacuum, but so did Russia, to save Syria. The sign says it all. More and more joined the war, like these fighters calling themselves the Shield of Aleppo. Neighborhoods fell to the terrorists. Seen here firing at a Syrian army's helicopter. Religious monuments like the famous Umayyad Mosque not spared. Syrian troops seen here regaining territory. In this demo, alliances had shifted, some pro-government, others against. But Daesh persisted, holding on to the stronghold in Raqqa.
And I'm back because of your arrogant foreign policy towards the Islamic State.
Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi is dead.
Assad and Russian forces were falsely accused of killing civilians. Yet the U.S. and its allies were fueling the war. The cry of pain. The moment after a bombing, the devastation afterwards.
Joining me in the studio is Amar Waqaf. He is the founder and director of Gnosos. His Twitter address, @TheGnososView. It's an organization expressing stakeholder opinion in Syria and the Middle East. Now, he's been a major contributor to the war in Syria, and he has appeared on numerous media outlets to give a realistic view on what is happening in that country. Amar Waqaf, welcome to the program. Taking a look at what has happened this 10-year anniversary of this war, it's beyond imagination the devastation that this country has experienced, and it's going to be futile for me to have you engage in what has occurred, but I'd rather have you look at what how things can be fixed, that is. I mean, Syria and Syrians, the path forward, how do you think that is achievable, do you think?
Well, I tell you what, you know, being a Syrian citizen and understanding things on the ground, the first key issue that should take place is that Syrian or Syrians agreeing that the objective of throwing out the government is not going to be realized. Once the majority of Syrians, even those who have been hopeful for the past 10 years for NATO to come, for, you know, whatever thing happens that could overthrow the current government, Once they realize that this is not an achievable objective, because what we hear also is a lot of fanfare about UN resolution 2254 and, you know, constitutional committee, and the way these things are viewed by this segment of Syrians is not about political, reconciliation or, you know, political realignment. It is actually being seen, or these are actually being seen, as tools to overthrow the current government. And they keep dreaming about, you know, Russia ordering Assad to go, Iran being bombed and withdrawing its troops, and, you know, having this catastrophical or apocalyptical sort of solutions. None of that is going to happen.
Okay, thank you, Omar Wahab. We're going to have him back a little later on. Taking a look at now our next report, we know that the war has had an effect on the Syrians when it comes to their nutrition. Aside from poverty and unemployment, one of the outcomes is food insecurity. It's a consequence that is plaguing a large majority of the population there.
After a decade of conflict and displacement, Syrians are facing the worst humanitarian conditions. Millions have slid into hunger in the last year alone. But that's not all. The collapse of the Syrian pound, its impact on the price of basic commodities, the fallout from the financial crisis in Lebanon, as well as large-scale displacements, all to further exacerbate the situation. COVID-19 pandemic has made that situation worse. Some 4.5 million have sunk into hunger and food insecurity. The findings are shocking. A record 12.4 million Syrians, nearly 60% of the population, suffer from food insecurity and hunger today, double the number in the year 2018.
You have COVID, you have loss of the value of the currency itself, and then you have mass displacement. So when you put all of these things together, there is no surprise that we are seeing rising food insecurity, rising hunger, not only in the breadth, meaning lots and lots of people, but also in the depth.
The number of people who cannot survive without food assistance has doubled in 1 year, reaching 1.3 million people. Food prices have increased by more than 200% just in the last year. Some Syrians have not eaten meat and fruit for months due to the high prices.
هذا قذيفة أم أبو الأولاد ارتعب أنا كنت ساكنة بمنيان ارتعب أم حس بوقتنا أم اجيته تفاجأت اجيته جلطة على القلب لأبوهم قضينا ما حدا قضى لحمة من عيد الكبير ما فات لعندي لحمة بنزل أنا بتفرج على السوق بتفرج على الخضرة بتفرج بلاقي أسعار
Our next guest joining us in the studio is Derek Ford. He is a lecturer at DePauw University. Now, according to his bio, his research and teachings are situated what he calls the nexus of educational theory and contemporary politics. Derek, welcome. Russia, Iran, and Turkey have keen interest in a united Syria to prosper. But U.S. allies like Saudi Arabia, like Israel, well, they are destabilizing Syria. They're preventing economic advancement in that country. Israel bombing Syria routinely. Shouldn't this be addressed in order to eliminate this catastrophic economic devastation taking place there? Because no one is going to invest in a country that is being bombed or that is fueled with instability.
Yeah, absolutely. And, you know, President Joe Biden, in one of his first acts, even before he addressed the needs of the people in the United States, was to bomb Syria yet again and to claim self-defense, as if, you know, the U.S. has any right to claim self-defense in Syria where they haven't been invited by the government, and they're there as an illegal occupying army, right? An illegal occupying force. And so they obviously give the green light to Israel for those bomb droppings. And I think that that's one of the main obstacles. That, you know, the war has to end, right? There has to come to an end. It has to come to an end. It's been going on too long. There's been way too much suffering. And the objectives that the U.S. and its allies set out to achieve haven't been attained, and they are, in fact, unattainable.
Well, what about these sanctions, such as the CSAR Act? That was like the final blow by the previous U.S. President Donald Trump before he left office. Not only do these sanctions, like the CSAR Act, worsen the existing humanitarian crisis there, well, it has deprived the Syrian people of their chance to rebuild their lives through their infrastructure rebuilding. I mean, is that the U.S. aim?
Yeah, that's definitely the case. And, you know, a Lancet Medical Journal article from July of last year, I believe, noted the sanctions' immense impact on Syria recovering from COVID-19. And so I think the fact that, you know, the blockades, the sanctions are aimed really at that tells you what they're really about, you know? I mean, for one, the sanctions are for government-controlled areas, right, which is just legitimate Syrian territory, where 70% of the people live. And so they've cost, you know, hundreds of billions of dollars. There's sort of runaway inflation. It's an annual, you know, it's at the highest annual inflation rate ever, just because there's a scarcity of goods, scarcity of jobs, and so on and so forth. And so obviously it's part of the war, right? It's not a separate, it's a tactic in the war to try, despite 10 years of resistance and really victory, to overthrow the Syrian government.
Very well, thank you for that. We appreciate it. Derek Ford, lecturer at DePauw University, with his comments there. Okay, we're about to take a short break here on Economic Divide, but don't go anywhere as we have plenty more coming up after these short messages, so stay right where you are. It's time now to take a look at our final report, which is really a close look at the CSAR Act. Now, the previous U.S. President Donald Trump and his team were responsible for executing it. They claimed that it would target the government only, but doesn't that mean Syrians would suffer? Some argue for and against it, but take it from us here in Iran. We know U.S.'s real intentions. After all, we have been the target of U.S. sanctions.
Today, we begin a sustained campaign of sanctions against the Assad regime under the CSAR Act, named after the brave photographer who 6 years ago brought the world documented proof of the Assad regime's brutality against fellow Syrians. These targeted designations seek to deny the regime revenue and support that it uses to wage war and to commit mass atrocities against the Syrian people.
And then, قانون قيصر اللي بيعمل هذا الحصار الشديد على الدولة وعلى الشعب في سوريا هذا القانون هو آخر الأسلحة الأمريكية.
Несмотря на это и на призыв генсекретаря ООН к смягчению санкционного давления в условиях пандемии, и в Вашингтоне, и в Брюсселе принято решение продлить рестрикции против Дамаска.
قانون قيصر ما بيأثر لا على النظام ولا أعمدته
نحن من زمان من سنين كتيرة كانوا عم يعانوا السوريين خلال الحرب من موضوع الكهرباء بسبب تخريب شيء بالبنية التحتية بسبب الحرب هلأ صار السؤال هل يا ترى نتحول لطريقة تانية أو لشكل تاني من أشكال تعب الكهرباء بالبلد
الخوف على الأجهزة الطبية الموجودة عندنا هي الأجهزة أغلبها مستورد أغلبها موجود من برا يعني ما عندنا أجهزة تصنيع أجهزة طبية بخصوص الأجهزة الإلكترونية
Today, the Assad regime and those who support it have a simple choice. Take irreversible steps towards a lasting political solution to the Syrian conflict in line with UNSCR 2254 or face ever new tranches of crippling sanctions.
شركات اللي هلا موجوده وجايه تعرض معظمها شركات جايه مشان مرحلة إعادة الأعمار، وأكيد هدفها مش هو إذا من يعني إجمالا يعني هدفها مش هو البيع للأفراد أو للتسويق بالأسواق، هي جاية لكرمال العمل والتعاون مع مشاريع الدولة والوزارات.
بازار سوریه در حال حاضر با توجه به اتفاقات تلخ گذشته که وجود داشته درش میتونه یک فضای مناسبی برای بازار مسکن و مشتقات وابسته به مسکن باشه. به نظر من میتونه یک بازار رقابتی خوبی ایجاد بشه در کشور سوریه که نه تنها خود ایران بلکه بقیه کشورها میتونن بیان اینجا از این وضعیت استفاده بکنن و دعوت هم میکنیم که از بخش خصوصی ایران بیشتر بیان توی این موضوع دخالت داشته باشن و شراکت بکنن و همچنین صنایع وابسته به بخش ساختمان.
Time to bring back Amar Waqaf, founder and director of Gnosos, with the Twitter hashtag at the Gnosos View, an organization that expresses stakeholder opinion in Syria and the Middle East. Okay, Amar, welcome back. There never has been really an effort to bring down a government like in the case of Syria. So many foreign players, the U.S., Israel, Saudi Arabia, for example. What are the U.S. aims in this country? I mean, why has it spent all this energy on this war when it could have spent that energy maybe on finding a political solution, or better yet, to push an economic solution to heal the nation so that it can move forward?
Well, basically, the U.S. aim has been, since the very start of this crisis, is to effect and gain political, geopolitical influence in Syria. With the current Syrian government, the way it is aligned, either with Iran or Russia or whatever, basically anti-Israeli interest in the region, that was not going to happen. So the only way to do it is to bring it down. That's option number one, and bring another or a replacement government or a political a body that could adhere to such interests, or be forced to change its course of action, basically by starving its to death, and this is what's happening, because the first objective didn't happen. They couldn't do it. There were enough Syrians whose interests really laid in keeping the government on its feet. They sent their children to military. They suffered a lot, and now they're suffering very much. So the next possible thing for the American policy is to force the current Syrian government to compromise with its needs in the region. What is really happening is that the Syrian people are really suffering. We need to understand also that the United States isn't only effecting sanctions that are suffocating Syria, they are also preventing Syrian people from benefiting from their own resources like wheat, water, electricity from the Euphrates, and most significantly oil. And now when Syrians need to import oil, their tankers are being targeted and everything. So all in all, there is a double action to suffocate the Syrian state, and this, my opinion, inadvertently, is actually pushing Syria more towards the strengthening the alliance with Iran and Russia.
All right,
and China,
well.
Of course.
Great. Thank you so much for that. We appreciate Amar Waqaf, founder and director of Gnosos, there with his comments. Right now, it's time to take a look at one of the worst affected and perhaps the most traumatized segments of the Syrian society, namely children. Hundreds and thousands of them have lost their parents to this war. One shocking figure, nearly 5 million children were born inside Syria over the past 10 years. But the following faces tell a story of pain and wounded hearts.
What's your name? Where are you, Abu? شنو متريقة متغدية متعشية؟
In our in-depth section, we are going to take a look at Syria's war, but in numbers. We figured that's the best thing to do. 10 years of war, upending the lives of millions of Syrians, a natural outcome of this war. The economy, as a result, it has pummeled. And along with that key infrastructure, it has been ravished. Here are some of the numbers. First, the human cost, 450,000 dead. In terms of the people who have fled this war, 4.5 million. And the people who are missing, it is recorded to be roughly around 200,000 people. Next comes one of the darkest chapters of this war, instances of chemical weapons usage. 38 have been recorded, and in one attack, only 1,400 were killed. The world blaming Assad, but it turned out that the terrorists had actually staged many of those attacks, if not all. Now the economy, ravaged to the tune of $1.2 trillion. Over the course of 10 years, $91.5 billion lost revenue from hydrocarbons, and 98% the devaluation of the Syrian pound to the dollar on the black market. In terms of food prices, 33 times higher across the country. Taking a look at the children who are facing hunger, 60% of the population of children. And in terms of poverty, you're looking at 2 million people. Now, our final look at the numbers comes to infrastructure. Energy grids in that country, 70% are out of order. Hospitals, only 58% are functional. And when it comes to schools, in terms of operational capability of them, 33% are in ruins, which leaves roughly about 67% that are working.
شيء 10 15 شخص يشتغل بنفس المكان هذا اللي احنا فيه هلا عايشين اللي احنا من هلا من هالمكان هذه
احنا هون نلعب السيارات نشتغل نطبق خزايف ونحن مخافي على مخاف تجر علينا شيء خزيفي ويعمل عدة اصناف خزايف مليانه
احنا من ضيعنا جينا هوني تجم من الساعة 6 نطلع نروح كل يوم احيانا توقف لنا سيارة احيانا لا نروح تجم مشي نروح نوصل الى ذا شيء انا نشتغل نجي مثل الصباح اذان المغرب نجي نحب نجي من الاختبار
When it comes to the war on Syria, it appears that it has faded from the headlines. I said that in the beginning of the program, but it shouldn't. For starters, Israel is bombing that country over and over again. Another country that is occupying it, namely the U.S., well, it's stealing its resources, namely oil, which the revenues could go to the desperate people of Syria. But there's another reason why Syria should not fade from the headlines. It should serve as a reminder that the U.S. push for regime changes and the redrawing of the map of West Asia or the Middle East has failed. Meanwhile, there's another path to changing the dynamics of the region, and that is economically. For where there's economic prosperity and trade between countries, there are less tensions and chances for war. That does it for this edition of Economic Divide. If you have any questions or comments, do send them to us the old-fashioned way. Our email address, economicdivide@presstv.ir. From Mikave Tavai and the entire team, it's goodbye. Until next time.